Dash, formerly known as Darkcoin, is a privacy-focused cryptocurrency that uses a mixer called CoinJoin, which we talked about in the previous section. In Dash, in addition to traditional proof-of-work rewards, there's a secondary network layer of what are known as masternodes. Users who run masternodes are tasked with performing privileged actions such as voting on proposals for network governance, instantly confirming transactions, and mixing coins. The idea here is that we have better plausible deniability because everyone is forced to go through CoinJoin for mixing. So this makes for a much larger anonymity set. The way it works is as follows. By default on most Dash clients, users have mixing enabled. Dash calls this private send, but it's essentially the process of executing CoinJoin plus some Dash platform-specific formalities. When a user has private send enabled, meaning that they want to obscure the origins of their funds, their client will first prepare a transaction. The transaction inputs are broken down into standard denominations of 0.01-, 0.1-, 1-, and 10-. Then, a request is made to the masternode network, indicating that you're trying to obscure the origin of your funds. When other users send similar requests indicating that they too are trying to make private transactions, a masternode mixes all the transaction inputs of all the users and instructs all users to pay their now transformed inputs back to themselves. So now, all users who participated in this round of mixing now has the same amount of Dash back in their possession, minus some transaction fees. In order to fully obscure their funds, of course, users need to repeat mixing with masternodes multiple times, usually between 2 to 8 rounds. Users of Dash wallets have the whole mixing process happen in the background without any intervention of the user themselves. So when it's time to make a transaction, their funds are already fully anonymized. After all, this whole process of mixing does take some time, so it should be done in advance. Also, since coins are mixed in set denominations, transactions using mixing may need to spend for more transaction outputs than those that don't use mixing. And spending for more transaction outputs at a time leads to larger transaction sizes, so users would have to spend more on transaction fees than usual. Some pros about Dash are that firstly, it solves the main issue of plausible deniability that we saw earlier. Everyone takes part in the CoinJoin mixing process. Also, since Dash uses decentralized mixing with CoinJoin, it's trustless on that end. However, there is the main con, though, that users have to trust both the main Dash network and also its network of masternodes. In order to become a masternode initially, users post 1,000 Dash bond. And after that, masternodes also earn interest and standard income through a proportion of the block reward. If there's an entity with enough capital, they could purchase enough masternodes to subvert the Dash masternode network and potentially de-anonymize the network. Unlike a lot of other altcoins, especially earlier privacy-focused altcoins that were forks of Bitcoin, Monero was a fork of another privacy-focused altcoin called Bitcoin, which, in turn, was based off of CryptoNote anonymous technology. Monero provides guarantees on transaction untraceability and unlinkability, guarantees on sending and receiving Monero. Untraceability means that for each incoming transaction, all possible senders are equiprobable, thereby hiding the identity of the sender. Unlinkability means that for any two outgoing transactions, it's impossible to prove that they went to the same person, thereby hiding the identity of the receiver. At a slightly deeper level, Monero's functionality hinges on the use of an advanced topic in cryptography called ring signatures. When a user wants to make a transaction in Monero, they choose some set of previous transaction outputs to mix with. These are then bound with the user's transaction output they're spending from in a cryptographic ring signature. In this context, ring signatures allow the user to prove that they own one of the outputs without revealing exactly specifically which output. The anonymity set in Monero is the set of outputs you're signing from, and since mixing is enabled by default like in Dash, Monero has better plausible deniability than some other non-privacy-focused altcoins. The main distinction between a ring signature with an ordinary digital signature is that with a ring signature, any verifier of the signature cannot establish the exact identity of the signer. In this diagram, say Alice constructs a transaction from herself to another user, Romulus. She constructs a ring signature with her public key, as well as that of Bob and Carol. Now, Romulus won't know exactly from whom this transaction was sent. Only the fact that it could either be from Alice, Bob, or Carol. And at the bottom here, the same situation. Bob wants to send a transaction to Remus, so he makes a ring signature with Dave's public key. So in these two scenarios, both Romulus and Remus have no idea where these transactions originated from, and can only guess from their respective anonymity sets, those whose identities were involved in constructing their respective ring signatures. As a quick aside, the reason why it's called a ring signature is the ring-like structure of the signature algorithm, each of the incoming arrows being data encrypted by various users' public keys. So while ring signatures give us the wonderful property of not being able to figure out from whom these transactions came from, it's still possible to see who transactions are directed to. And that, in turn, might be able to provide some insight into where transactions are coming from in the first place. So we need the property of unlinkability, and that's implemented in Monero as well. For each payment, Monero clients will automatically create a unique one-time key, each derived from a user's public key, and this ensures unlinkability. So in the diagram here, two one-time addresses are paying to Bob's public address. Now, when Bob wants to spend from this, he can redeem it using another one-time address. We could somewhat do this in Bitcoin, where the best practice is to generate a new address for each transaction conducted. However, users' money would be all over the place, and they would have to keep track of each and every address generated, or have some way of deterministically generating these addresses themselves, perhaps through a hierarchical deterministic wallet. What Monero does is similar in that the one-time addresses are generated deterministically. It also allows for easy retrieval since everything is linked with the user's public key. So for the conclusion, let's look again at some pros and cons. Few coins have formally proven the anonymity behind their product. Monero is one of the few, as is Zcash, which we'll be talking about in the coming slides. Also, transaction values are obscured with cryptography as well, though it has been a bumpy road in the past, due to bugs in implementation of ring signatures and other security vulnerabilities. But it seems like all is well at the moment on that end. Also, Monero has some good scalability choices as well. It has a fast block time and allows for variable block sizes, making it flexible during high and low traffic times of network operation. As for cons, due to all the cryptography that is performed to ensure privacy, transaction sizes can be quite large. For example, the size of a ring signature is linear in the number of public keys in your anonymity set. However, works in recent years have shown that it is possible to achieve the same functionality with sublinear space. Also, Monero has a pretty decent anonymity set, the number of identities involved in a ring signature. But we can do better. Zcash is an altcoin where transactions reveal nothing about input and output addresses, and also the input and output values of the transactions as well, allowing for fully anonymous payments. The way it does this is by using zero-knowledge, succinct, non-interactive arguments of knowledge, ZK-SNARKs for short. We talked about this briefly in the last lecture on scalability, but in a nutshell, ZK-SNARKs are a way of proving that you know something without revealing what you actually know. One side note is that UC Berkeley's own Professor Alessandro Chiesa is co-founder of Zcash and co-inventor of its underlying protocol, ZeroCash. Both of these technologies rely on ZK-SNARKs, as we mentioned before, and Professor Chiesa is also the author of LibSnark, the C++ implementation of ZK-SNARKs. We'll go into this in more detail later, but what you can do with ZK-SNARKs implemented at the protocol layer is that you can first have a normal publicly viewable base coin, such as Bitcoin. You can then mint it into some black box coin, which you can then, in total anonymity, make a series of transactions. There's no way to correlate or distinguish coins and values while in this black box. Then, to get your base coin back, there's a procedure called pour. So let's take a closer look at this. If you recall, in Bitcoin or any payment network, you need to prove three things in order to conduct a valid transaction. Firstly, you have to prove that the input you're spending from hasn't previously been spent, or more generally, that you have sufficient funds for the payment. Secondly, you have to prove ownership of the coins you're spending from. And thirdly, you have to prove that the sum of your transaction inputs is equal to the sum of your transaction outputs. In Bitcoin, proof that coins haven't been spent previously is information obtained from the ledger itself, and it requires no effort by the transaction sender. The sender proves ownership of the coins that they want to send by digitally signing the transaction using their private key. To allow the signature to be publicly verified, the sending address must be disclosed. The recipient address also has to be disclosed in order for the recipient to then be able to spend coins that they have received. In Bitcoin, it's easy to see that the verification of transaction inputs and outputs is trivial, since so much information is disclosed and publicly available. On the other hand, Zcash uses zk-SNARKs to prove the same three facts: that inputs haven't been spent, that coins are being spent by their correct owners, and that the sum of inputs is equal to the sum of transaction outputs. And this is all done with zero knowledge, without revealing any information about the sender, recipient, or the assets that are being transferred. Each valid transaction is sent with an accompanying zk-SNARK, which prove the three facts which we previously stated. Transaction inputs are proofs of validity for the transaction, and outputs are the details required to construct the zero-knowledge proof, encrypted, of course, with the recipient's public key. The information required to spend the transaction outputs is also attached to the transaction, again encrypted, and details how to construct a new zk-SNARK that enables spending. Zcash has two layers, a transparent layer and a zero-knowledge security layer, and users transfer their assets between these two layers using the mint and poor transactions, as we mentioned before. The reason for having these two separate layers is because, at its core, the fundamental innovation of Zcash was its implementation of the zero-knowledge security layer. Its transparent layer simply started as a fork of the Bitcoin codebase. Users are generally more likely to be comfortable with transparent cryptocurrencies that they've seen or used in the past, like Bitcoin. So if users like that, then Zcash shouldn't take that away. Also, enabling Bitcoin-style transparent transactions also make it simple to integrate with Zcash using existing tools and infrastructure that were originally built to support Bitcoin. So now, a fun little technical aside. ZK-SNARKs are built on top of homomorphic encryption functions. They have the following properties. The first two are pretty standard, and if you've been around since our first course or have experience in elementary cryptography, then this should be fairly familiar. Firstly, given an output, it's hard to find the input. Also, different inputs should lead to different outputs. Where this starts to get interesting, though, is that now, rather than wanting homomorphic functions to be random, we want to be able to perform operations on outputs of homomorphic functions. For example, if we know the outputs of a homomorphic encryption function on two different input values, we can find the output of the function on some arithmetic combination of the two inputs, all without knowing the input values themselves. In other words, we want to allow computation on ciphertext, generating an encrypted result which, when itself decrypted, matches the result of the computations as if they were performed on the plain text itself. Here's a simple way to grasp this idea of homomorphic encryption. Say Alice has two numbers, x and y, such that x plus y is 7. Alice doesn't want Bob to know x and y, but she wants to prove to Bob that x plus y is 7. Alice sends f of x and f of y to Bob, where f is a homomorphic function. Bob can then find f of x plus y from f of x and f of y, since f is homomorphic. Then, Bob can check if f of x plus y is equal to f of 7, verifying the fact that x plus y is indeed equal to 7. And that's, at a very, very high level, how some of the math works behind Zcash. Alice, in this case, doesn't reveal the values of x and y to Bob. Those can be transaction inputs. However, Bob can verify that those two values combined equals some output value. So, some final thoughts on Zcash. One pro is that Zcash is fully anonymous. Assuming the underlying cryptography is secure, transactions conducted in Zcash's black box zero-knowledge security layer are fully anonymous. Their anonymity set is the entire black box history. Also, another pro is that of modularity. Zcash was originally implemented on top of a fork of Bitcoin for convenience and also integration with existing tools. However, it can also be integrated with any other consensus mechanism. On the other hand, Zcash is very resource intensive, and that's due to the fact that ZK-SNARK proof systems in use require about 4 gigs of RAM and 40 seconds of computation on modern CPUs in order to generate proofs for our poor transactions. Also, proofs require a semi-trusted one-time setup. Adversaries with malicious setup parameters can mint coins without spending base coins. This can be somewhat mitigated with a secure multi-party computation setup, but that's out of the scope of this course. It's an interesting challenge in integrating such technologies into blockchain, though, so it's definitely worth checking out.